you for tuning in to the Realities Podcast. Realities Podcast is a blog-term podcast about the realities of life, what's trending, being a mom and a wife, family, career, and everything in between. I hope you enjoy this next episode, but please make sure that you follow us on Instagram at Realities, and that is R-A-I-A-L-I-T-I-E-S. Let us know what you think about this next episode. Enjoy. Welcome back. We are back. It is Black History Month, and we are going to talk to some awesome people today. G is with me as usual. Say hello, Gina.
Hello, Gina.
It is Black History Month. As I said, last week, we played a game. And so hopefully everyone got a chance to see the game that we played. And this week we're going to talk about a game and a book and a series and some great things that's happening that I've been noticing on Instagram as well. And so I want to introduce our guests today, Paris and Kona White. Say hi.
Hello, everybody. How y'all doing?
So Paris and Kona have written books and have created a game, and I have my book here, and my book was signed, where was this?
About 2019, early 2019. Yeah.
Yep. So, well, it's actually was to Kenzie, but okay, I have.
So the spelling of my kids' names are.
Yeah, we definitely have to give you a copy.
Yes. So I have my book, and then we also have the game in which we're going to get in more detail about. I can tell you guys, we played this game 3 times already, and I already have the kids who are saying, you told us we was going to have so-and-so and so-and-so come over so that we can play the game again. So I'm sorry. It's amazing, y'all. I'm proud of you guys.
I saw your video, you know, I watched your video, you guys playing. I just want to say that y'all cheated your daughter. Yeah, because she won. And y'all was like, nah, you got to roll the exact number. I was like, y'all cheating a baby. That is ridiculous.
No. In all fairness, you know, Black people play differently.
That's why there's good rules. Yeah. The rules of the game. So you can go ahead and make your own rules.
I love it.
So tell us about you, who you are, who you guys are. I know Paris, you're an author. Tell us about that. Let's start off there.
I started out writing short stories when I was in college. My first classes, my teacher told me that I had a creative writing style. Like all the papers I turned in, she said they were like essays and stories that I wrote because, you know, I made everything so lively. So she encouraged me to take creative writing. And from there I developed poetry and I did poetry contests at, you know, busboys and poets and, you know, and won competitions up at American University. So I became a really good writer. And then of course, when I met my wife, you know, I really developed my poetry skills with her. And she the one that kind of encouraged me to, you know, write the stories of my childhood into a book so I can share it not only with my daughter, but with everyone else.
Awesome. And for those that have never met Kona, that's Kona. Kona is my home girl from way back then at our convention center days. Don't tell nobody.
Yeah, so what do I do now?
Let's see. Everything. Mm-hmm. But how about what don't you do? That might be
rest. So right now I am in contracting, and as a hobby I cook. So I have a small catering business that I haven't really dedicated a lot of time to, but it's something that I do when I have the opportunity to do and when the business is there. And it is called Flavor Feathers. And let's see what else. So that's my little side business that I do on the side. And then I guess I'm his wife and his business partner.
My business partner.
That I guess.
My boss. So,
that's pretty much it. I am the backbone to this right here to keep him pushing in the right direction.
You can say that I'm the creative talent and the person that's out, you know, with the face of business. She's more behind the scenes, handling the books, making sure that everything is taken care of on the website and so on and so forth. So we wear a lot of hats. You know, I think she wears like a lot of business management hats. She does a lot of, she's web designing now. And because so all these things we're learning on the fly as we're doing it, but it's coming out really, really great. We're taking the time to learn it and learn it from the bottom up. So the experiences that we have, I'm even now at this point passing wisdom down to other people who are trying to start their own business, because, you know, what I've gone through from starting from scratch, where I was making a game at home myself, you know, making it from making a board game and the cards and everything myself, and learning how to put it on a computer and graphically do it. So, and from making the songs for the game, you know, and the videos and stuff like that.
Very organic.
There's a lot of hats we're wearing, you know, right now, trying to get it done.
So, the book came out first. And like I said before, I have the book, The Urban Legend. So what inspired you? Well, first, what year did you write the book? Because I know the book is came before the game. And the book is pretty cool. Like I was saying earlier, it it's to Mackenzie, but I keep it in my own bookshelf just to make sure it stays together. But tell us about the book. Like, what inspired you to write the book? Any hurdles that you came across when you was writing the book? I know we attended your you read a couple of pages to us, to the kids, and that was really cool. And Kona did cook. Chef Kona did cook. So tell us about your book.
Okay. What inspired me was when my daughter was little, when she was 5, 6, 7 years old, and you know how kids want to, you know, they refuse to go to bed on time. So I used to, you know, tell her stories. I used to tell her the stories of things I used to do in my past, like the little adventures and crazy things I used to do. And it became a habit night after night. And she just asked for it every night. Daddy, can you tell me something? I almost ran out of stories, but I have so many stories because I was a wild and crazy, you know, I was a boy. You know, I was dirty. You know, you can't even, you know, you couldn't put me in clean clothes and expect me to stay clean until we go wherever we're going. So I would tell her these stories of how the trouble I got into. Sometimes I got a beating for some of the things I got. And she just found it so funny and amazing how I lived through some of the things that I've been through, you know, and I decided to write them into a book when about 6 years ago, I started writing a book and I kept picking it up, putting it down. You know how when you first start a project, you're not sure about yourself. So, you know, eventually I got the book done and it wasn't, you know, until I got it done that the gas really turned on, because I went to a book show in New York and I really saw how things were supposed to happen with authors and publishing houses and stuff like that. And I actually ran into some great people up there who were outside of the book expo, was doing a book expo for Black authors. And we got invited to that. And I really got inspired there. I met writers from the New York Times and local business owners, bookstore owners and stuff like that. So once I got the book done, it was a year later that I had the game done. I was off my gears, but I had already been turning for six years. So when it came to get the game done, it came out right away. And it just, the more time it took me was, you know, drawing it out and then having to redraw it on the computer and add the color. So it's been a great adventure about getting that book done, because the book is what sparked all the ideas that's coming up.
So one thing you just said was, as far as the game is concerned, drawing out everything. So you not only wrote this book, you actually did all of the artwork in the book as well.
Yes.
So y'all really are just one show. Y'all ain't need nobody for this.
Right.
And trust me, I tried to find, as you mentioned, Kona, I tried to find people to do it because I was like, I'm gonna write the story. Somebody else can do the art because I'm not that great an artist. But then I looked around at local artists and I was like, well, I draw just as well as they do. Why would I pay for somebody for something I could do myself? So I just went ahead and did the art. And then it was like, okay, now I got the game. So who am I get to do the game? And again, it was no one. I even tried and someone told me, and it was like, you know, do it yourself. You'll feel better. It'll be exactly the way you want it if you just do it yourself and draw. This one over here, yes.
Oh, yeah. Someone what?
She definitely was. And she has been such an inspiration and a drive really behind what I've been doing. From the moment we met, she said, you know, what do you want to do with your life? You know, and before, in my mind, I was like, I'm probably going to be working the rest of my life. I had a decent job and I was really happy where I was. But, you know, when someone said, you know, I want to be in a relationship with you and I want to see where this is going, but I don't want to be stagnant. So, you know, we sat down in that day and we said we wanted our own businesses and we wanted to have something of our own. So 6 years ago, we started on that journey and here we are now. And, you know, there's a lot of ups and downs getting here, you know, where I kind of lost my faith. She may have lost faith in me, but, you know, we push each other. And, you know, even went through her endeavors, you know, we work together really well. And, you know, I say love conquers all, but a strong woman pushing you along the way is a great thing to have behind you. And I can say I definitely have a strong woman.
Oh, that's amazing.
That is great. So I want to kind of go back real quick. So you said your teacher kind of put you in the direction of becoming an author or writing and doing poetry and things. Did you go to school for like creative writing or something like that? Or did you go to school for something else?
I went to school for architecture. You know, my father, you know, I wanted to, in life, I wanted to be a comic strip artist. Like you see in the newspapers, like, mm-hmm. Yeah. You know,
you like, about to pay somebody.
Right. But my father said, you like to draw, go to school for architecture. So I went to school for architecture. Now, when the English teacher I'm telling you about failed me, she failed. And I tell my mom, I'm going to drop this class because every paper I'm turning in, I'm getting D's or F's. I don't understand. And then finally, I sat down and met with her, and she said, you are a creative writer. You know, I need papers on the subject, and you are telling these stories. Like, you know, adding your own stuff to it. So, you know, I failed the class. I didn't pass, but I took creative writing the next year and I got all A's. I was a wonderful story writer. So that kind of, at first it deterred me, you know, because I worked really hard on these papers and, you know, turn them in. And then, you know, from there, it just turned into something else. And then once I started at Morgan State University, and then I moved to UDC where I continued in architecture and really developed my drawing skills because when I went to UDC, I could start my architectural classes right away. So that kind of excited me more. And I finished at Maryland State University Night School. So by the time I got out, I had a well-rounded art background and writing background. So it was the teacher who failed me, who really pushed me along the way.
And Gina is a teacher, so Gina, you may be inspiring some of those you're failing.
Yeah,
great, yes, thanks.
No, don't do that to them.
failure is just triumph. You know, you don't.
It is.
You know, I wasn't meant to, you know, do that. So what I'm doing, it pushed me. It sounds like everything we've done leading up to this point has been a step that you can look back and say, oh, that's why I did this, and that's why I went through this. And it's definitely been a blessed journey, I must say. You know, ever since the game arrived at my door, it's just been a blessed journey.
I know, we were waiting. As soon as that game came, Kona was like, it's here, girl, it's here. Like,
oh, man.
So the kids she's talking about are mine.
I was supposed to have your children to play, and but I never got her.
My kids have been to the house multiple times. And she has said absolutely nothing.
No, it's been like a month, so it hasn't been that long, or 2 months, about 2 months.
When was that post?
I don't know. Paris personally delivered my game.
I did. Right around Christmas time, I was frosty. the urban legend. I was going to people's houses delivering.
Yes, indeed.
I wanted people to play before Christmas. It was important to me. And this whole project is important to me. So it was important to me to make sure people got the games in their hand before Christmas and it didn't get tied up in the delivery services and stuff like that. So I told people, if you want a game, email me, text me, I'll deliver it to your house. I have some great photos with people when they receive the game. And, you know, I got Rayshawn, one of the pictures you sent me of you and your family playing made me cry. It made me cry because
spot.
She was like, "Are you crying?" I was like,
the video, and he was like, "Okay, so I'm pressing play in the video." And I'm looking over at the dog or something, and I look back and he this is great.
He's like that. He's like, everybody likes my baby. My baby that came into fruition.
Because, you know, I dreamed of when I was young, I had something like this that I could play that represented me when I looked at the war game. So when I saw you and your daughter and both your daughter, even your small daughter, who was baby shark. It was so precious. And I was like, wow, this is what I made this game for, to bring families back together for game night in an exciting way and fun way. And I know sometimes it's hard to finish because, you know, you get set back so many times, but that's kind of what makes it fun. Like, you just ain't gonna finish this right away. You know, because when you're going around, you think that, she's going to get right to the end, but it's not that way.
Not at all. I learned that several times. I was like, I was in there cursing. I said, I'm playing with the kids. I was so mad. Like, this took me all the way back to school.
I have a great story. Yesterday, I've been one of the first stores that allowed me to have my game in their store, Gallery Africa. The owner had been having me help her out in the store because
shout out to Miss Arita.
Yeah,
I'm about to say it. Is that
the Prince? Yes.
Oh, yeah, Gallery Africa. I'm about to say that.
Africa and that
Woodmore Shopping.
Okay, that's what I was about to say. Wait, that's right down the street. Okay.
And I had opened up the kiosk this previous weekend in St. Charlestown, and I was only there Friday, Saturday, and Sunday, so. A lady came up on Sunday looking for the game because her husband had was over someone's house that was playing the game, and he was watching them play, and they was having so much fun. And he was like, "Can I take the game home?" And the guy was like, "Nah, you gotta get your own. Nah, you can't take my game." He sent his wife up to the mall to get the game, but I wasn't there, of course. So she called me and asked me where I was, and I even said I'll deliver it to her tomorrow morning. She was like, "No, he wants it tonight." So she drove all the way from Indian Head, Maryland to Landover to pick up the game. And I said, "You know, you did all this. I'm going to sign the game for him." I said, "What's his name?" And she said, "What's his childhood name?" And she was kind of embarrassed to tell him. I said, "It doesn't matter what it is." She said, "Nut." N-U-T. Oh. I'm like, two nut from Paris. You know? I didn't care. It was impressive that, to me, that was another one of them things that won my heart, that somebody traveled to come get my game. They wanted it that bad. So that was really nice. Yeah.
That is amazing. We're going to get into the game because I'm saying, Gina, Gina, you can't borrow it, but we're going to play.
I hope you see my face.
I don't need to borrow.
You're not invited. I don't need to borrow your game. I'm going to get my own game. Thank you.
No, I'll deliver it.
We still coming over to play it. With all your new wine that you got. So.
Hello? The service is bad. I can't leave.
Go ahead, G.
So, you probably already going to ask it, but so you have this book, The Urban Legend. What's the whole title of it?
The Urban Legend.
Summer Adventures, The Journey to Be Cool.
Okay, I couldn't read. All I saw was cool. I was like, I know it's more.
Yeah.
And then you have The Game. What do you have? What is in your mind, or what do you have already? What have you already started coming up next? Yeah,
I have the Urban Legend trivia cards. They're called legendary trivia cards. The first deck that's come out is 50 cards, and they'll represent African American culture as well. They're called legendary trivia cards, African American top 10. And you'll have in those 50 cards, you'll have African American athletes, artists, inventors, politicians, and leaders of our time. So in that deck, you'll be also be able to incorporate those trivia cards. Well, you'll be able to play Trivia Pursuit, Pictionary, and Charade style game, but you can also incorporate them into the board game because the board is a huge picture pile. So say you found all the items and you don't use those cards anymore, you can still play with the one set of cards, but now you can also incorporate these trivia cards into them. So now when you land on a certain spot, you'll pick up a trivia card. Someone will read the clues like first Black president, married to Michelle Obama, you know, two-term president. You're like, okay, Barack Obama. And in Trivia Pursuit, you will get 3 points, but on a board game, you will move 3 spaces. So you'll have trivia cards that you'll be also be able to incorporate into the game. And there'll be 4 decks of those. So in each deck, 50 cards. So the next deck after that would be the Urban Legendary Trivia Cards, African-American Entertainment. So you're talking about where kids will learn about Berry Gordy, Michael Jackson, Tyler Perry, Oprah Winfrey. So they'll give, you know, you'll learn about living legends that's, you know, did so much for Black people, into this present time. And then the next deck is African-American First. You're talking about first gold medalist, first Black president, you know, first, you know, female tennis player to win 6 Grand Slam, you know, titles and stuff like that. And then the last deck is African-American history. And that's the things we've done in America and abroad throughout time. So overall, you end up with 200 trivia cards that you can incorporate into the board games. And there's going to be 4 books. It's called the Urban Legend Series because there's 4 books and 4 board games that's coming out. This is just the first set. The next board game will be the Urban Legend Fall Olympics Going for Gold, where I took out childhood games like freeze tag, hide and seek, red light, green light. And then
they don't even know about those.
Yeah, they don't even know. And so, I'll explain how to play those games in a book so kids can learn, you know, if they did know how to play, or parents, you know, they'll be able to take it down and play that. And then when you play in a board game, it'll be incorporated in the board game. So now you may have to run around and playing red light, green light, somebody 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, red light, and you got to make it back to your seat before getting caught. And
it'll I'm ready.
That's going to be amazing.
I'm ready. That's going to be
Gina,
amazing.
Gina, do not let the kids in the school play this, these games now. She about to integrate them into her.
That's all Black History Month right there.
Yes.
Every day doing social studies. So you you got to add your name to the first of one of those series, because that's the first time I've ever heard somebody be able to incorporate the cards, like trivia cards, into a game.
A game, yeah. Mm-hmm. And so you got to think, it already plays like Candyland, Monopoly, and Where's Waldo. So now when you add the trivia cards, now you got a whole trivia, you got like 4 or 5 games built into one game, mm-hmm. and stuff like that. And even, I don't know if you guys remember when you had to play like hide and seek, and you had to figure out who was in you, everybody would put their feet in, you have to go bubblegum in the that built into the game as well, you know.
My
mother told me to pick. So, you know, those things are being incorporated into the game as well.
But it also teaches the kids the real words to this. Y'all know these kids don't say the real words to these things.
No, they don't.
No, they
because the kids these days are just little rough things. They don't
hear.
Yeah.
Like they add extra stuff. I'm like, y'all know that's not how that go, right? Yes, it is. I've been here longer than you have.
You know what? You know what's embarrassing when I tell my daughter, I'm like, you don't know who this is? This is Tupac or Biggie or somebody like that. They're like, who? What? I ain't never heard this song. I'm like, you ain't never heard this, but. And then she's like, I want to play my music, and I had to turn that right off.
Yes, exactly.
Can't play your music.
So the Urban Legend series is based on your childhood and growing up, and like you said, the crazy things you did. So tell us a little bit more about just a couple things in the book. We don't want to give it away because we want people to buy the book.
Oh, okay.
So we don't want to give them too much of what's in the book, but just give them a little bit of maybe the characters and really what that summer was about. Because you did some crazy stuff. You should have got your butt whipped, Paris.
This one book is about just one summer?
Just one summer, yeah.
Yes. He should have got his butt whipped.
Like, I'm looking at the book and it looks like it's a good lengthy book. Yeah. And that's one summer.
It's definitely, it's a lengthy book. It's a lot of pictures in there, but it definitely has a lot of story in there as well, because there's at least four different adventures that's in the book. One of the stories that, was actually a story that was true to me, it was the neighborhood dogs that were in our neighborhoods. And we didn't have them little dogs. We had like pit bulls, Rottweilers, and, German shepherds, and they chased you. You had to jump on somebody's car and run for your life.
That part. Done that.
In the game and in the book, there's a neighborhood dog that's called Fluffy. They had these cute names, but this dog was a killer. So I named him Chewbacca, because you're more likely have him chewing on you before you hear him bark. So,
oh, that's cute. Yeah. I like that.
Yeah. Another story, we built a go-kart to go down the steepest hill in our neighborhood. Mm-hmm. And that really happened. And my brother and Gene, my brother and my cousin Antoine and my brother Gene, they bailed out on me in the go-kart and I crashed at the bottom of the hill. So that's in the story. There's also, I guess I call it the rite of passage when you little to jump off the high dive in your neighborhood pool. When you're young, you're in the baby pool, you start out in the baby pool and you get in the water and you start working your way to the deep end. And somebody say, you want to jump off the high dive? You're like, I ain't trying to die, and I ain't that good of a swimmer, but you end up doing it as a rite of passage. I was crazy. It was a lot of things. I don't know if you guys remember, it's another part of the book. When you go to, say you went to King's Dominion, you get on a roller coaster and you get in there and you put your seat on and you seem like you got a lot of play in your harness. You like waving your hand for them, like,
don't miss up.
Not yet. And they counting down and you like, wait a minute, cause and you holding on for dear life once you take them on that roller coaster. So a lot of things. I almost fell out of a roller coaster actually at Six Flags. I was there on the Superman and it was like a lawn chair on wheels. And I almost fell out of that thing. I was holding on. I'm telling you, I was holding on for dear life.
That's why you never get on the Superman. Never. The drop is too much.
It's
too
much.
Get on nothing at Six Flags.
Exactly.
You got to get something.
I'm gonna get on the swing. How about that?
Especially and with the daredevil kids you got, I'm gonna be on everything. Okay.
Yeah, I'm getting on everything. I don't care. I'm ready to go.
At a certain age, you can't get on it no more. It's against the law. There's certain age you just don't do certain things anymore.
Well, I don't even think I could fit, so it doesn't even matter.
No, you can get in. If I get in there, you can get in there. You're all right.
So, okay. Now, with these stories and this book, please tell me how many butt whippings did you get? Because it's no way your mama didn't send you outside to go get a switch.
All the time. And that's a lot of the story. If you read the story in the book, a lot of it is me back talking to my mom under my breath and stuff like that, and trying not to get caught. She's like, you gonna take the trash? And I'm like, you gonna take the trash out? And she's like, what? And I'm like, no, I said, I'm gonna take the trash out, no problem, But I thought that's what you said, that she looked over her glasses at me, it was a lot of, beatings. And I got my brother in a lot of trouble, too.
Yeah, that's true.
My brother called me a snitch, but I ain't a snitch.
Hey, I'm the little brother.
It's always the younger one.
Whatever you got to do to get yourself out of trouble.
Exactly. My mother didn't do anything to my brother. He could get away with murder. And no matter what I said, he didn't get in trouble. It's just the amazing thing to me. And even in the book, it says that. Like, he never gets in trouble. So, I'm getting a lot of my frustration in that book, too.
Yes, indeed.
So they left me hanging a lot. My cousin and my brother left me hanging a lot.
Was the baby. They didn't want you dragging around being the snitch.
No, they probably thought because he was a baby, he would get it easier. Mm. Probably. Yeah, it didn't work out on your end, though. It doesn't sound like it.
Yeah. And actually, the board game is a representative of my neighborhood. I grew up in Washington, D.C. and Southeast. So when you look at the board game, you'll see
they're walking all the way through it.
Mm-hmm. I don't want to get in too much because y'all need to buy y'all own game.
Oh, I'm on my way.
I give y'all the top pop.
Okay.
No, you got to at least give a neighborhood, and that'll tell us what part of South with an F. East.
Oh, okay. I was born in in Benton Park, Eastgate apartment over there, Eastgate. So I was on that side of Southeast where the shrimp boat is and stuff like that. So Simple City, J.C. Knoll, Fletcher Johnson High
School. Look at this son.
Oh, yeah.
Wait, what this son got in his hand? Is that a purse?
No, that's his fist. He got like a boxing glove. Yeah, because in the story he said the sun is knocking out people like Mike Tyson.
Yeah, that's
the hottest summer ever. Yeah, it's the so the story of the book is. I'm sorry, I think Rayshawn asked me that earlier.
Yeah, like, go ahead.
So the story of the book goes: it's the last day of school, and it's the hottest summer ever. And me, my brother, and my cousin try to find things to do during the summer to stay cool. Before the end of the summer, where we have the block party, which was usually Southeast Day, where the go-go bands would come down. You might see Frankie Beverly up there if they was in town, or Parliament if they was in town. Whoever, you know, nice band. You may have Junkyard, or I remember it was Junkyard, and they were playing Sardines and Pork and Beans. I was up there, and you know, it was just great growing up. When I was young, before, you know, drugs kind of came into the neighborhood and changed it. It was a community and everybody looked out for everybody. And that's what I drew, that community that I used to have in my neighborhood. You know, you can go anywhere. And if you did something wrong, somebody, you know, who saw you doing it was going to tell your mom, I saw your son up there doing that. And you still got to be, even though your mom didn't see you, but the neighbor saw you or someone up the street,
right.
You know, told you doing it. So. It was a community that I really, really loved and enjoyed. And it was to me, growing up in DC was a small thing. And it wasn't until I went to college that I really saw how big the world really was and how much I kind of really wasn't exposed to and how much I was protected, you know? And then when I came back, you know, the neighborhood from college, the neighborhood was totally different. And, you know, half the people I knew was gone and so on and so forth.
What year was this? What summer was this?
I was born in 74, so you're talking about the 80s, you know, the bad 80s with the drug epidemic and stuff like that. But before that, when 80s, late 80s into the 90s was a drug epidemic. But, you know, when I was like, up till I was like 14, 15 years ago, it was nice. It was really nice growing up. And I just remember every weekend it was a cookout or somebody was having, you know, if one side of your family's having a cookout or your another side of your family's having a cookout. So every weekend you were somewhere, but it doesn't seem like it's like that now. So we kind of, I wanted to get families back together. And, you know, due to COVID, a lot of things have just, you know, stopped. And unfortunately, you know, this would have been a great game, you know, for families without COVID, you know, being in schools and stuff like that. But we are where we are. It's still doing pretty good despite COVID. So
I think though with COVID, it's helped us because, you know, you're stuck in a house.
Mm-hmm.
You're trying to figure out what to do. I mean, I remember at the beginning of COVID, we were doing Zooms with each other, with the kids, creating science projects, having them to mix and try to blow stuff up. And it was, you know, the moms getting together, trying to just keep the kids active because we didn't know what was going on. But I think definitely having a game like this not only brings families together because we get so busy and so caught up in life that, you know, we forget what's important, which is home. Mm-hmm. So I definitely would say a game like this is amazing to bring families together. I mean, I had cousins over here that I just say, typically they don't come to my house, man. Not all of them invite them to my house. I love y'all though, but and they played the game and enjoyed it. I mean, I did have one that was like, "Oh yeah, can I take it?" Mm-hmm. And I'm gonna take it over my mom's house, and I was like, "No, I will direct you to the website if I'm able to purchase it on your own." But it's no take it to my mom's house and come back with my pieces missing. I'm be fixed. Yeah. Mm-hmm. I'm like, because I'm the one, I'm gonna count all my cards. I'm counting all my pieces. Don't crack my timer. Mm-hmm. I want all my stuff back, just like it is, like it was packaged. I want it back the same way. it's a really fun game, and I was going to show Gina a couple of them. So it's some of the cards in the game. And on Instagram, I posted on my personal page some of the highlights of the game, and I'll repost it just in case so people can see it more up to date. But we even had the baby playing, Rashida, my sister Rashida's baby. Mm-hmm. She was in the game, and Rashida had to run around the game board yelling. I think she had to yell, "I'm on fire." Mm-hmm. So her aunt Brea was just running around the game board, pulled over her head, was just she's yelling, I'm on fire. And my mom actually posted, I didn't even know she did that, because my mama posts everything, but one of them was I had to sit uncomfortable backwards.
I didn't see that one yet.
I think that was on Facebook because my mom's not on Instagram. Mm-hmm. And she sat there recorded and was just talking all kind of trash about it. She's like, look at her. Mm-hmm. Real uncomfortable, ain't you?
Oh, yeah.
I didn't even know she recorded. I happened to see it. I was like, you put me on Facebook.
I get videos of people playing the game, and I have to edit out all the curse words, because when grown people play, it's a different game altogether.
It's a different game.
And some of her friends from Jersey sent me some videos, and I had did the video, and I was cracking up laughing because, you know, I'm grown. I'm going to put grown stuff out there. But she was like, you can't put that out there on the videos because kids going to see it. I was like, oh. So I had to edit all the cuss words out. But it was so much fun. The video is still funny, but it's even funnier with the curse words.
It is. And that's all we was doing. They actually flipped it.
Oh,
go ahead, Kona. What was you about to say?
Oh, I said they already started making it into a drinking game.
Mm-hmm. Yep. That's what we did.
Uh-huh.
For sure.
Well, and I was, and it just occurred, I had to tell the kids to get, I'm like, y'all kids got to go. Y'all making me mad now. Y'all messing me up. I keep rolling the one. I'm getting pissed now. And I kept going back. I don't know how I kept landing on one. I had to keep going back. I had to go back to the hill. They ain't gonna heal cold. Yes, I had to keep going back. I was so pissed off. Yeah. And I just, it was like, I will move. And it would tell me to move back, or somebody would pluck a card, and it's like everybody has to go back three spaces. I was like, mm-hmm. You're kidding me, right? And for us, it was, I forgot how they did it. They incorporated drinking into it, of course, but it was if you didn't do what the card told you to do,
take a drink.
And half of them being all, you know, I don't want to do that. Y'all record me. Okay, well, we're going to record you taking this drink.
Oh, yeah.
So take the drink. So, yeah.
I had one thing. People, they're like, don't put that on Instagram.
I can't make that promise.
Kona has even made a debut in this game.
Oh, yeah.
What in the chicken?
Oh, yeah.
No, it says it's backwards on the screen, but it says Kona pose for a picture. So if you pluck this card, you had to be Kona and pose for a picture.
Mm-hmm. Now, in the book, Kona is the neighborhood tattletale. So, and she was she's like, why you make me the tattletale? Because she was a snitch. She always telling.
Oh, that's messed up, man.
I put her in there as the neighborhood tattletale. And she's running, and actually in the game, she's been taking pictures of me like not
being successful
in my adventures. So, and she blackmailed me into being her her boyfriend and want me to buy candy every day. And actually on the board game is a image where that I'm proposing to Kona. Uh-huh. I'm down on one knee proposing to her.
And can't nobody find Kona on that board, and I'd be cracking up laughing because you got to find her before the time will run out.
Mm-hmm.
And I'll be the one like, I'm looking right at her on the board. Y'all can't find her. And I'm like, hurry up. Let the time run out. As soon as that time ran out, I was like, she right there. I was pressed. Let me see what was coming. But now I can't even find her.
She up there by the
up here. She up here.
That's me
proposing
to her, right?
Uh-uh. Y'all see how big that board is?
This board is big. It's on the all way up here.
Uh-huh.
But everybody keeps looking down here.
He hit a whole Where's Waldo.
Yeah. It's so much
like it.
Yeah. Who else? Kwasi is on there. His daughter. Friend that passed away. His name was Kwasi. He's on the board.
He's the DJ.
Yeah.
Her is on there. She's like the last little character that tells you if you land on her square, you got to skip your cute little self back home.
Yeah.
Because
she wanted to be on the board game jumping rope. So I asked her, I was drawing it. And I said,
she's near the finish line.
Right. She's right at the finish line, the little jumping girl jumping rope.
And then you're gonna make her, you gonna make somebody start over if they land.
Yeah, they said so when you land on her spot, it says excuse.
That's the type of stuff that's gonna make you make people not like your daughter. Like, why would you do that?
Oh, you
She a whole grown up now. She don't care.
Yeah, she don't care. She's up there. So
she is right here.
Uh-huh.
So, you land on her.
I'm telling you now, I land on her. I'm on your comments, like,
get her off of here. On her, don't you gotta go all the way back?
Get back home, home, yeah. Right there to the right, all the way over to the
right. Where it says start? Oh, home. Oh,
but you might as well go to start. I ain't done but 10 spaces back.
Yeah, but there's cars that send you all the way back to school. So
yeah, that was me. I kept going back to school. I don't know how. I think they was setting me up because I'm like, the car, it wasn't that many cars to send me back to school.
Well, there's different things that'll send you back to school, right?
Yeah.
So if you the sun hates me square. But if you count the wrong number of spaces, you get sent back to
wrong keys.
To the sun hates me.
You roll a dice off the board, you gotta all the way back to the sun hates me square. Because that's why the sun is mad, he hates cheaters. So if you count the wrong number of spaces,
you don't pay attention.
Yeah, you gotta go back to the sun hates me square. Yep. You roll out a turn. Oh, no, you should have been paying attention. You got to go back to the sun.
So when you're playing, if a player's not paying attention and they move your man instead of their piece,
and by the
way, don't say nothing. Just let them go ahead and move the piece.
And if you get mad because that happened, that's because of Kona, because she's a cheater. And she was like, oh, if you roll a dice off when I was developing the game, you roll a dice off the board, you should have to go back. And I was like, what? So I incorporated that into the game. So, it's a lot.
It's like playing Monopoly. Because you know how Monopoly can just keep going.
Yeah.
Eventually, so like the first time we played, Mackenzie won.
Mm-hmm.
6-year-old beat us. I was so mad. I'm like, no, we're going to keep going. She won. All right, you first. Let's keep going. They like, that's not how it goes, Rachel. I'm like, let's keep going. Like, I'm not losing to this child.
But you really did.
It took me so
long. I did. I just wouldn't accept it.
I can't beat my own game. Paris and her, they team up. And they keep sending, I'm the one they keep sending back, you know, and I'm the tallest always. So it's one card that say, switch places with the tallest player. So I'm always the tallest. I go all the way back. And they just get a kick out of making me lose. And they so petty. They cheaters. And it's okay. But, you know, I win sometimes. And when I do, I rub it in.
Exactly.
The one time
you got to invite somebody over that's taller than you.
Yeah, that's what it is.
Like, all right, we're gonna put him back.
Right.
Awesome.
So I'm excited about the game, but here's what's gonna happen, right? I'm gonna figure out how to pay it through the website, but still come get it because I want it signed.
Don't worry, I'll sign it for you.
I want it signed.
Don't worry, we'll take care of it. Yeah, you guys will get a free. You'll get a free game. Don't worry, I'll give you one. So don't worry.
That is so cool.
And it's been times like I'll be selling a game. I'll be somewhere selling a game. I'll do a pop up shop, and then it'll be a family that come up, and they're like, "Oh, we'll get the book, but we can't really, you know, afford the game right now." And it was right before Christmas, and I'd be like, "You know what? Here, take a game. I'll sign it for them." You know, it's been so many times that, you know, families come up and I'll just give a game away or I'll give them a book because they'll get a game. But I see that they, you know, their kid was interested in a book. So I'll be like, you know, go book. It is not, you know, to me, it's I want people to enjoy it. So it's my way of giving back as well. You know, if you buy that, you know, that's awesome and great. But it's times that I have an opportunity to extend my generosity to someone else. And I do it a lot. So
that he does.
Yeah.
Very.
And we also are doing this Black History Month. We're doing a book drive where we're doing a book drive for, not for homeless shelters or libraries, we're doing a book drive for daycares where, you know, African-American entrepreneurs have daycares, but, you know, a lot of them are getting supplies with their own money or their ex and parents to get supplies. And this is where our kids are most of the day. And we rarely take our kids to the libraries and stuff like that. So I'm doing a drive for local daycares so we can get books in their hands as well and giving them a free game. So when they're there, they can play the game. So I'm donating a game and a book and a deck of trivia cards to them to the, I think it's 8 daycares that we're doing. And then the books that we get from them, we're dividing them up and distributing them to the daycares according to, you know, the age range of kids that's in the daycare. So, you know, we're giving back. And ultimately, we want to start a nonprofit where we're going into schools and teaching financial literacy so kids don't, you know, mess up their credit. They learn how to save money, you know, how to pay their bills early, you know, and not wait until the last minute or wait till they're behind. And then, like, you know, like something like I grew up, you know, I didn't have a great structure with, you know, bills and stuff like that, but it's needed.
It's about teaching our kids the value of money.
Yeah, and learning how to invest as well.
Very, very important.
That's good. So the book drive is the month of February.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Awesome.
A little late. But yes.
Yeah.
So if someone wanted to donate, can people donate books to you guys to, or donate, like how, if someone wanted to participate by donating something to you, what does that look like?
They can email me and I can come pick up the books at the urbanlegendsseries.com. And if they're local, I'll come pick up the books. And it's a local drive. So I'm not going to ask people to mail heavy books to me. So it's a local drive. So anybody that's on my website, I'll be posting stuff soon about it. And probably, I've been doing so much. I'm wearing so many hats. But I'll be posting soon where people can drop books off and where the daycares are that I'm doing the drives for. So that'll be posted soon.
Awesome. You guys are amazing.
Really are. So really, okay. Really quick. You've done pop-ups. Are you getting ready to do when is your next upcoming pop-up and where?
Well, I have this weekend I'll be at St. Charlestown Mall. I'm opening the kiosk back up again Friday, Saturday, and Sunday. And then the following
right around the corner.
I'm on my way.
So yes, I'll be there Friday. If you want to come up and get your game, then you can do it then. And
Excuse me, sir. I'm getting both. What do you mean? Stop playing.
Yeah. And, that following weekend, I'm at Ethnicities and There you go. Uh-huh. In Bowie. And then later on at the end of the month, I'll be at in Forestville Mall at a pop-up shop. I can't think of the name right now of the store, forgive me. But I'll post that as well. I'm doing another pop-up shop. And then in March, I have another one that I'm doing in New Jersey. So in April the 10th, I'll be in New Jersey. But I'm starting to expand to more malls. So St. Charlestown Mall is first. I'm trying to probably be either Columbia Mall or Arundel Mills Mall. I'm trying to do that where we populate a lot of these malls so I can get it into more hands, because I feel as though it's something that's been missing in families for a long time.
Definitely.
That represents us. And, you know, when people come up to me, I tell them, I say, you can go into Target and Walmart. If you go get a game that represents us like this, I'll buy it from you. Because I did the research. I did the market research. There's nothing. There's no games that represents us. Not even trivia cards. Me and her, about 6 years ago when I was writing a book, we went out to, you know, try to find a game that represents us, and we looked nothing. We went online, nothing. I was like, that's incredible. Why is there no game? So we sat down and started coming up with ideas, and we were laughing then, and we was, you know, having a drink or two, of course, but we was coming up with all these crazy ideas. We were like, oh yeah, put that in there. And those ideas stuck with me for 6 years. So when it was time to do the game, it just spilled out onto the paper. Like, really, it came out really, really nice. And I play tested it, and I with kids, with me and my wife, they're like, oh, we got to play the game again. Yeah, you got to play the game again. You know, yep. I sat up here by myself, you know, and I was all three people, not all one night. I did it a lot of time. And it's like, you still up there playing the game? Because I was playing all three of us, you know, going around the board, making sure the mechanics of the board game was good. And then, mm-hmm. you know, sometimes you may get into a long game, but it's not meant to finish very, very fast. So mm-hmm. the more people play, the longer it takes. But when you're playing with two, three people, it goes pretty fast. So
are the trivia cards out now?
They'll be out at the end of March. Only reason okay. they're not out yet because I'm waiting for the supplier to open back up. You know, it's their okay. new year. They won't be back open until the end of February. So, but you know, it takes them a little minute to get them printed, but they'll be here. And I'm also doing, I decided to do a deck of playing cards with my logo on it as well. So
yeah,
there'll be playing cards as well, like regular poker deck cards as well. You know, because someone came into the store for the last 2 days, and it was like, you should do a game for seniors because seniors need something, you know, to occupy yeah. their mind shop. So I was going to do I want to tell everything. But I'm not going to tell everything because...
Yes, keep it a secret. Keep some things a secret.
Yeah, something that's coming for seniors to definitely, you know, that they can have in senior facilities that they can play, that will keep them active as well. So...
Well, we got a couple more minutes, but I definitely want to say thank you both for joining us and... So everyone that listens or that watches the playback of this video, make sure that you visit St. Charles Mall this weekend.
First or the second floor? And what side are you?
Right by the food court. Center stage. I'm telling you, I've met so many great people. You know, you just wouldn't believe. This has been a truly blessed journey.
But see, that's what happens when you tap into your natural gifts that God has given. You know,
exactly.
You're able to share it with others and you're able to, you know, feel that love and just that energy from it. And I really think if you guys couldn't tell already, he is truly a natural storyteller. Like truly natural. His eyes tells the stories right along with his facial expression. Like he is truly a phenomenal storyteller, and I just think that this all kind of just I can't even explain it. It just kind of layered itself perfectly for him to see, like, hey, I really do have some talent here, and if I just believe in that talent that God has given me, I'm pretty certain that talent is going to take seriously.
Absolutely, and. You know, we're in Black History Month. So definitely that the dynamics of you guys as a team is amazing. I mean, definitely you can tell that, you know, it's not necessarily that Kona is your backbone, you're her backbone. You guys definitely mesh. You guys definitely, you know, everything. You could tell almost like what he was about to say, she was saying, or what she was about to say, he was about to say. So, right. You know, working as a team, I mean, it's amazing. It's not too many households in our community that has, you know, that mom and dad, that husband and wife. So, you know, for people to be able to see you guys and see that, you know, it's actually real people out here that, you know, grew up in Southeast DC or Jersey.
Everyday folks.
In Newark.
Right. From Newark, New Jersey, and, you know, took their passion and made their passion, you know, something that you guys did together. So it's doable. And so I definitely love how you guys love. I definitely say, I really definitely salute you guys on your book and on the game. Like I said, we played it, and I'm not saying it because we're friends. Because if it wasn't good, I'd be like, nah, y'all.
Tell me if it wasn't good. I would be like.
Exactly. I would tell you. But it is really a fun book. I mean, it says ages 8 to adult. But like I said, I had my 2-year-old playing. We had that the 6-month-old playing, or how old is she? No, she 8. I don't know how many months. She's not a year yet. But had the baby playing. We had the whole family playing. So it's definitely a game that taps into your inner childhood, and it's just fun. And so I definitely am looking forward to the trivia cards. I'm looking forward to number 2. So the set number 2, I know this is set 1 for the series, and there's plenty more to come. Yeah. So I'm definitely looking forward to it.
I'm looking forward to hosting an adult game night the game.
Here for
that's what I'm looking forward to, ladies. So
yes, look out, we are here for it.
It's back to
normal. Yeah.
Yes. And that's not to everybody. That's not to all the listeners. All y'all can't come. But
no. You think
so? Everybody be like, "Oh yeah, I'm in there. Tag us in it." Nope, we didn't say that.
Exactly.
When was your last test?
Exactly. So I definitely want to say thank you guys for joining us. It's been amazing. I know it's only been, you know, only an hour, and we can talk on and on about the book. But I want people to actually go and purchase the book. We'll be posting where you guys are so that everyone will know and they can come up and get the book and the game, not just one. You got to read the book to understand the game. That's how I'm telling them.
Yep.
And so you need to have both. And Paris is not giving no discounts because you heard the podcast. Pay what the cost is, folks. I know our people be real.
Can I get a discount? I listen.
Right.
No.
Be real.
No. You know, you'd be surprised. I have people buy the game and like give me extra money to help me when they believe in the project. Some people don't buy it, even get the game. They just give me money. Like, you know, I don't have no kids or anybody to get a game to, but here you go $20. Here you go $10. Here you go, you know.
That's good. We're supposed to support each other. And I say it all the time. Like, if I'm supporting a friend, a family member, whomever, I'm supporting what they have. It's not okay, hey, can y'all give me the book free and give me the, and I'll pay for the game? No, if the game and the book cost $60, then that's what $60. Yep. And so Black folks, y'all know I say it. Black folks, pay the cost. Okay.
Yeah, I didn't price anything out of price range. The game
they can afford it. They out here buying Starbucks for $9, some damn coffee they can
buy. I don't buy no Starbucks. Okay. Right. The Keurig machine. So how much is the game and how much is the book?
The game is $34.99 and the book is $16.99. But if you come up to the mall and you can buy the bundle together, you can buy the game and the book and you'll get $5 off. Or you can buy the game, the book, and pre-order the trivia cards if you want. You can pre-order trivia cards by itself. And that way I'll pay the delivery free and ship them to you free. So, and the trivia cards are $11.99. So, you know, I'll deliver them for you. If you pre-order them, when they come out, when they arrive, I'll ship them to you. And I'm keeping everybody updated of when they'll be here. So.
Oh, well, just know when I get there on Friday or Saturday.
Her hand ain't gonna look like that, so you might not know who she is. She changed her damn going hair.
My hair will look like this. I just got it done. So it will be this way.
You're gonna get the same great service regardless.
I need to make I'm pre-ordering.
This is your pre-order.
This is my pre-order to go pre-order.
Yeah.
Awesome. Well, to all of our listeners, please make sure that you follow Paris and Kona at the Urban Legend Series on Instagram. Make sure that you also check out their website, and correct me if I'm wrong, it's at theurbanlegendseries.com.
Yes, that's correct.
Awesome.
Yeah, Facebook is the same, the Urban Legend Series as well. So,
awesome.
Urban Legend Series. Yeah.
So they are on all platforms, no excuses, folks. And the game is not just for, you know, us color folks. It's for everybody. It's for everybody.
Everybody will be able to understand us a little more. Mm-hmm.
Yes. Now, when we get to the trivia cards, then some of our other friends, we might have to help y'all out. But
just a little bit.
We'll get to that when we get to that.
I got one email. Somebody will say, email me, said, "I don't see any diversity in your game." And I was like, "You don't see diversity. I see brown people. I see black, I see Ethiopian, I see Colombian, Spanish, I see Dominican, some people are just so closed-minded. And then I responded back. I said, I didn't see any diversity in Monopoly, that's for sure.
For sure.
No. I see a lot of diversity. I see orange. Everything is
not for everyone.
Like we, right? Exactly. Like, let us have fun.
And that's why I left it in the book. I left the characters uncolored, so the kids can personalize the book to them to color whatever they wanted their characters, whatever color they saw fit. Mm-hmm. I left it to their imagination. So.
And that's when we got the book. That's what Daryl told Mackenzie. Say, oh yeah, and they said that you can color in the book. So I was
which
like,
you will not do.
But we're not gonna do.
Which you will not.
So it stays in mine. It stays in here. Because what you're not gonna do? No, you can't color in this book. No, dang on kids ain't gonna color in the lines. I'm gonna be mad.
I ain't even gonna tell my kids that. No.
No, read it and put it back. Read it and put it back. I ain't even telling her names, and I skipped that page.
You're disrespectful in that part.
What? She'll know when she get old enough to understand the value of books.
So bad.
They don't know the value of books. They know the value of YouTube. They don't know the value of books. Mm-hmm. So. Mm-hmm. All right, you guys. Thank you again. It's been amazing.
Thank you.
Thank you, Gina.
Thank you. Thank you, guys.
Awesome, y'all. Well, have a good night. But make sure that you listen to the podcast. Download it on all podcast platforms. This was our Black Love for Valentine's. Happy Valentine's.
Happy V-Day, people.
Happy V-Day.
Valentine's Day.
So thank you again.
Thank you, guys.
Thank you.